Hello, this is going to be part 5 of my series of videos on Michael Allen Gillespie's book, The Theological Origins of Modernity. Here it is once again. And as always, all of the books that I discuss or even just mention in this video will have links to their Amazon pages included in the description. If I'm able to find PDFs of any relevant thing, I'll include that as well. Now, today, I'm going to be talking about free will. Now, the specific focus of this video is going to be on the debate between Martin Luther and Desiderius Erasmus on free will. But I thought that in making this video, it would be wise to give kind of a whirlwind tour of the idea of will and of free will in Western thought, so that it would be easier for anyone watching this to really be able to situate himself into this debate and have the proper historical context that one would need to have to really come away from hearing about this event with a richer, more full understanding of the proceedings, of what's going on. So I'm going to do that first before I really get into the meat of things and discuss Luther and Erasmus and the history of the events going on between them, and then also the arguments exchanged between them as they debated. Now, I pointed out in previous videos when I discussed humanism and the Protestant Reformation that humanism and Protestantism were two different ways of responding to the problem generated by the nominalist God and his sort of radical, terrifying omnipotence. So even though humanism and Protestantism agreed on certain basic issues, they accepted the nominalist critique of scholastic realism, for example. Also, they tended to agree with one another, though not with the nominalists, that language was this almost living sort of vibrant thing, and that therefore if one were to interpret scripture or try to, you know, derive true understanding about the words there, one should undertake to learn the original languages in which the Bible was written, the Hebrew and the Greek. So there was this emphasis on language in both of them. Now, the nominalists, of course, viewed words as sort of mere signs, and they saw it in kind of a formal sense. So they disagreed with nominalism on that, but they did agree with one another. So, despite all of this, this rather great area of agreement between Protestantism and nominalism, they did clash. They came into conflict. And the kind of apotheosis, or the starkest example of this conflict, is that debate between Luther and Erasmus on free will that I'm going to discuss. Now, they came into conflict, these two ideological currents, because of the different ways in which they responded to the problem posed by nominalism. Humanism tended to emphasize man. It placed man and his will at the center of its view of the world and of its view of the cosmos and its understanding of things and so on. And Protestantism tended to be utterly theocentric. That is, God's will is all-powerful, and in the face of it, the will of man or of any other creature is a nullity. It's just reduced to nothingness. So because of this stark difference in emphasis, it's really not hard to see that these two ideological currents, these two worldviews, would eventually butt heads. And so, of course, they did. Now, in order to really appreciate what this butting of heads meant, I should pause, as I've promised to do, and give a sort of brief whirlwind tour of the idea of the will and of free will within some of Western thought, at least Western thought prior to this debate. So, the first thing to understand here is that there really was no concept of the will within Greek thought as we know of the will today. Today we think of the will as its own sort of autonomous, independent entity that's distinct from emotion or passion, and it's also distinct from reason. It's its own thing. It is that faculty which allows us to choose between various alternatives. That's how we think of the will now. That is a very modern conception. the Greeks did not see will that way. Rather, characteristically for them, they saw action as being motivated either by reason or by passion. So the will wasn't its own thing. It's all action could be motivated either by reason on the one hand or by irrational desire on the other. And that's really all there was to the Greek understanding of things. Now, despite not having a separate independent concept of the will, freedom was very important within Greek thought. So the idea emerged that if one is ruled by reason, if one's actions are directed by reason, then one is therefore to that extent free. And to the extent that one is taken possession of by irrational desires, one is enslaved, one is not free. One lacks self-mastery and therefore loses freedom to the extent that he lacks that self-mastery. You see this idea in people like Cicero and Seneca. That's going to be very important in a moment for what I'm going to discuss. Now, I think the best way to really highlight how the debate about the will and how philosophical discussions about the will went on in the ancient world is to talk about the series of debates and discussions between three schools of ancient philosophy: the Epicureans, the Stoics, and the Academics, or the Skeptics, as they were later called. I may use those two terms interchangeably. Sometimes I'll call them the Academic Skeptics, but it's the same group that I'll be referring to. So, first we have the Epicureans. Now, the Epicureans believed that the end of life, the purpose of life, was autarkia and apatheia. That is, self-sufficiency and freedom from inner disturbance. And they believed that the chief source of any kind of inner disquiet or disturbance or, you know, anything that would cause one to be uneasy or upset in some way, any form of sort of internal disturbance and kind of, general sort of badness, I guess. The main source of that, according to the Epicureans, was fear of death. And fear of death came primarily from two sources. One is from other men, and the other is from the gods. Now, the key to overcoming this fear, according to the Epicureans, and thereby achieving that inner harmony that they sought, is to first remove oneself from participation in the affairs of society, in political affairs, and to retreat into what was called the garden in Epicurean philosophy, by which they meant a sort of place of a private, friendly association with, you know, one's friends, one's compatriots. So you have this kind of retreat away from the world into private, voluntary association, and thereby you escape the source of the fear of death that comes from other men. Now, as far as the gods were concerned, the Epicureans believed that the way to overcome that portion of the fear of death is to simply, through philosophical understanding and training, come to understand that the gods are just not concerned with human affairs. They don't involve themselves in these things, and so the gods cannot ultimately be responsible for your death. They cannot pose a threat to you in that way. And again, as I said, having done this, one achieves a kind of inner peace and therefore a kind of freedom. So you could say that for the Epicureans, the end of life was to attain freedom as they understood it. Now, next come the Stoics. Now, the Stoics understood the end of life in a surprisingly similar way. However, there were certain crucial differences between them and the Epicureans. Rather than wanting to retreat from the affairs of the world into private association, the Stoics said that what one must do is unite oneself with what they called the Logos. And the Logos is sort of the Stoic term for fate, you know, the order of the world, that which organizes everything and gives coherence to the cosmos. In Christian thought, this later became a way of referring to God. But as the Stoics understood it, they meant fate. So what they believed is that a supremely wise man or sage could, through philosophy, come to unite himself with this incomprehensible fate. Now, having united himself with fate, he is not thereby freed from the kind of natural causative necessity that afflicts all things in the cosmos. He's still subject to that. But nevertheless, having united himself with the Logos, he does attain a kind of inner spiritual freedom that allows him to escape, you know, the petty cares of the world and sort of ascend above them. And the way that one does this is by way of what the Stoics called cataleptic impressions. And cataleptic just means that they're sort of sense impressions that are indubitable, they're irresistibly powerful, they simply impress themselves on the intellect, and they do so with such force that they literally cannot be doubted. They provide you with absolutely certain knowledge. So you attain this absolutely certain knowledge by way of these cataleptic sense impressions, you thereby unite yourself with fate, and you attain freedom. That's the Stoic understanding. Now, moving on to the academic skeptics. They eschewed all attempts to attain certain knowledge, and so they diverged from the skeptics in that way. They didn't believe that that sort of thing was possible. And what they pointed out to the skeptics was that for every seemingly indubitable cataleptic impression that one can point to, one can also point to an equally powerful, equally forceful, equally cogent impression which led one to something opposite to that of the first one. So for every impression, one can find an equal and opposite cataleptic impression. And therefore, that leads one to doubt whether what these sense impressions produce really is indubitable knowledge. And of course, the skeptics, as their you know, name should indicate, wanted to focus instead on what they believed to be merely probable or plausible knowledge. They did not think that certainty was a possibility. And they sought to draw other philosophers, particularly the Stoics, into debate by way of a series of rhetorical tactics. And by doing this, they tried to force them to defend their assertions. So a famous example of an academic skeptic in this line of thought is Carneades. He very much did this, where he tried to lure those who made certain claims to knowledge into debate, and then tried to expose what he believed to be the fact that they couldn't actually defend their claims to knowledge when it came down to it. Now, how does all of this relate to freedom? Well, the skeptics saw freedom really as freedom from illusion. So it wasn't escape from a fear of death. It wasn't a union with a kind of divine logos, or what they believed to be a sort of imaginary logos, because they didn't believe that the material world was ultimately real. They were skeptical even about that. So they didn't think that freedom came in those things. They thought that freedom came in freedom from illusion. Freedom came, according to them, in understanding that the world is full of all sorts of illusions that try to lead us astray by impressing themselves upon us and confusing us, but that if one follows the skeptical path and considers all matters from a variety of different viewpoints, one can arrive at probable knowledge, sort of good enough knowledge for practical purposes, but more importantly, one can free oneself from the tyranny of these illusions. And when one frees oneself from the tyranny of illusion, one once again acquires that kind of inner peace that all three of these groups of thinkers sought. Now, having set out the lines for this debate, the preeminent Christian response to this discussion came from St. Augustine and one of his earliest works. And that was a dialogue that he wrote. It was written in the style of a Platonic dialogue. It was a dialogue he wrote called Against the Academics, or at least that's how Gillespie calls it here. I actually bought a copy of it because I thought it was a very important thing to have, and it's translated here as against the academicians, which just means the same thing. I'll, of course, again, you know, include a link to where anyone who wants this can buy it or read it, etc. Now, so Augustine, in that dialogue and against the academicians, let's go with the Hackett translation, he crafted the preeminent Christian response to this. And what he said is this: the skeptics were on the right path insofar as they doubted the ultimate reality of the material world. Augustine was sort of like a Neoplatonist, and as someone coming out of that tradition, he tended to sympathize very much with that view of things. So the skeptics were correct insofar as they wanted to deny the ultimate reality of the material world, but in plunging themselves so deeply into skepticism, they got to a point where their own philosophical methodology prevented them from attaining the sort of knowledge that one would have to attain in order to acquire true happiness, be truly content and happy. Now, what Augustine said then is that the way to overcome skepticism, ironically, is to follow the skeptical path to its end. And when one follows the skeptical path to its end, one paradoxically comes upon indubitable truth. Now, how does he do this? Well, he says that one can doubt virtually anything. You can doubt that all that you see before you is really real. So for example, if you're watching this video, you can doubt that you're actually sitting somewhere and watching this video. You know, maybe it's all a dream, maybe it's an illusion, maybe you're in the Matrix, etc. That sort of philosophical kind of skeptical doubt. You can dredge up those things and potentially doubt anything. But when one begins to doubt the fact that one is doubting, one runs into a performative contradiction. Because in order to doubt, there must be one who doubts. And so you can't doubt that you're doubting. Right? It's contradictory to do that. And when one comes upon this performative contradiction, one is struck by an indubitable certainty. That being that you yourself exist. That you are alive and that you are here, you know, doubting. You exist. You're alive. And that's the one sort of rock, the one indubitable piece of certain knowledge from which all other things can be built. Now, for anyone listening who might know anything about philosophy, you might be saying, well, you sound like you're describing the ideas of René Descartes. Well, I am, but he stole those ideas from Augustine. That argument that you can't doubt your own existence, that came from Augustine first. Descartes nicked it from him. A lot of people don't know that. Actually, a few of Descartes' contemporaries, Pascal in particular, mocked him quite mercilessly for having done this. But it's been forgotten now. A lot of people don't know that. But that argument initially came from Augustine. So, having established the certainty of one's own existence, Augustine then goes on to say that by then following the path of faith, and by getting illumination from God. And he outlines his doctrine of illumination in the other dialogue that's included in that little book that I just showed him from the screen called The Teacher. That dialogue is a dialogue between himself, Augustine, and his 16-year-old son. And by way of that dialogue, he describes his doctrine of divine illumination. Basically, the idea is that God grants you grace, and he reveals certain truths to you, and these truths, because they're revealed by God, are just absolutely indubitable and incontrovertible. So you combine this certainty in your own existence with that which is revealed to you by God, and then you thereby go on to follow the path of faith. So what happens is, through philosophy, you can engage in the sort of Neoplatonic, Plotinian kind of ascent upwards to the divine. When I discussed humanism, I think I mentioned this briefly, where in Plotinus's thought, the purpose of life really was to refine one's thinking and through philosophy come to do away with the illusions and the seductions of the world, to come to understand the truth, and in that way to ascend slowly through the hierarchy of being up to God and eventually unite with God or with the One. Augustine agreed with that. He wanted to do that. But then also, through faith, one additionally comes to believe in Christ, he said. And then one, you know, believes in the resurrection, the forgiveness of sin, that Jesus Christ is the Son of God, and so on. And all of that other Christian stuff. That was the Christian response to that debate. Now, as Christian philosophy developed, and in the early days it was all done within a Neoplatonic framework, it ran into certain problems, and there were certain difficulties that had to be worked out before ultimate Christian philosophizing and Christian doctrine could be established for good and all. And now, the interesting thing about Christianity, its distinguishing feature, I suppose, is not really its monotheism, because it shares that with Judaism and then later with Islam. The distinguishing feature of Christianity is the incarnation. It's this idea that God became man, that he became flesh, that he inhabited the body of a human being and found a way simultaneously to be both fully God and fully man. And from that we get, the doctrine of the Trinity. You know, it's the divine Godhead expressed in three separate persons, right? So you get that idea. Now, the advantage of such a concept is that it allows for human beings to move closer to God, to gain a kind of communion with the divine. And this was very important in the late Roman world, because in kind of late Roman classical antiquity, that civilization was very much in decline by the time that Christianity began growing in popularity and spreading. And one of the reasons for that civilizational decline is that Roman paganism eventually afflicted people with a deep sense of fatalism, of a very gloomy, lugubrious kind of powerlessness in the face of fate. And so people were just sort of resigned and, you know, didn't care. This led to quietism and a kind of slow decline. This, by the way, and let me pause for a very quick tangent. There are some people on the alt-right, and despite some sympathies that I have with that broad strain of thought, there are some people on the alt-right, particularly those interested in paganism and that sort of thing, where they look upon the problems of the world as it exists today, and they diagnose them by tracing them back to certain Christian ideas. Now, this diagnosis is correct. I will agree that a large part of current cultural and social malaise and degeneracy has its roots in Christian ideas. I've even discussed some of that in this series of videos, so I agree with that critique. I agree with that diagnosis. Where these people lose me, though, is when they go on to say, well, therefore, Christianity must be rejected entirely, and Europeans, let's say, must return to their old pre-Christian pagan roots. Well, this sounds nice, but, they're forgetting there's a reason that paganism declined, particularly in the Roman world. I'm focusing specifically on the Roman world. You could argue about this for other parts of Europe, Scandinavia and the Northern Crusade and so on. I'm not going to go into that here. But at least insofar as the Roman world is concerned, there is a reason why it declined, why paganism declined. There were spiritual needs that people had that the paganism of the time was not fulfilling, and Christianity filled that void. That's why it spread. It spread, by the way, naturally. Christianity was already quite popular when Constantine adopted it. there's this kind of myth floating around that Constantine adopted Christianity and forced it on everybody. That's not true. It had been spreading naturally for quite a while before then. There are many arguments to be had on this topic, but all I'm going to say is that this idea that the Roman Emperor adopted Christianity and then began to stamp out heresy through the sword and sort of violently impose Christianity on everyone, this is cartoon history. This is nonsense. And I, to the extent that those on the alt-right or in the reactor sphere believe this, I have to wag my finger at them. Anyway, moving on from this. So you have this, you have within Christianity this notion of the incarnation. It allows for easier communion with the divine, and therefore that allowed it to meet the spiritual needs of the people of late Roman antiquity. But the problem with this doctrine is that it's very obscure. It's very difficult to explain to people. I mean, what do you mean God became man? How could a man become a god? A man is just a man. How could one be both a man and a god? You'd think you can only be one or the other. How is that possible? So this is a very obscure and difficult doctrine. And a lot of the debates within early Christianity focused on this issue. And you had basically four strands of Christian thought that in one way or another revolved around this problem. So you had the Arians, the Manichaeans, the Manichaeans, you then had the Trinitarians, and then you had the Pelagians. Those are the four. And the debates between these four all came down to questions of will, and then also to another question which became of great importance. And that's this. Christianity teaches that God is both all-powerful and omnibenevolent. He's totally good. He's purely perfect. He has no evil within him whatsoever. It also teaches that human beings deserve to be punished. They have sinned by way of the fall and deserve to be punished. So this poses another problem. If God is all-powerful, how can humans be responsible for anything? If they are not responsible for anything, how can they be said to be guilty of anything? If they are not guilty of anything, how can they be justly punished? And if God does not justly punish them, how can he be good? This is basically, at least in part, the problem of evil, but it also ties in with other problems about the will. Now, I'm going to talk also briefly about how these two issues, the notion of the Trinity, and then this kind of problem of evil and divine justice, how they were worked out within early Christianity. Okay. So, you had your four schools of thought. Your Arians, your Manichaeans, your Pelagians, and your Trinitarians. Now, the Arians believed that Jesus Christ was not God. He was just a human being. He was, according to them, the most splendid of the creatures, but he was ultimately just a creature. They thought of Christ in sort of the same way that a Neoplatonist would think of the Demiurge. It's sort of in that way. As the most splendid creature, the most powerful creature, but ultimately just a creature. Not God himself. And that was sort of their way of responding to the problem posed by the Trinity. They said there is no Trinity. And you don't need to coordinate divine and human will within the Godhead, because remember, you have a human nature to Christ, but he's also godlike. How do you coordinate the three wills of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit within the Trinity? The Arians answered this by just saying, well, Christ was not divine. He was perhaps inspired by God, the most splendid of his creatures, but not actually God. That was their answer to that. Now, the Manichaeans, their position was mainly concerned with answering the other problem that I mentioned, the problem of evil and divine justice. And they answered it by saying that there was not one God, but two. There was a good God, who was a redeemer, a savior, and then there was an evil God, the one who created the world and all of its materiality and all the problems associated with that. And according to the Manichaeans, the cosmos was engaged in a kind of titanic struggle between this good God and this evil God for the souls of all creatures, and that evil resulted from the actions of the evil God. That was their answer to the problem of evil. The Pelagians, their principal concern had to do with salvation. So within Trinitarian notions of God, there was this problem of coordinating the three wills of the Trinity together that I discussed. But then there was also the problem of how does the will of other humans, of mere human mortals, coordinate with the divine will. And this is where the Pelagians come in. They believed that God's grace was not strictly necessary to salvation. That through great, wonderful, moving, tremendous acts of charity, kindness, and goodness, one could, merely by way of the strength of one's will, attain salvation. I've discussed this idea previously, so this should be a recap. I've mentioned Pelagianism before. Now, the Trinitarians, who were the church fathers, the early, you know, Christian fathers, the framers and those who established Christian orthodoxy, they gave a Trinitarian answer to this. And the way they dealt with the problem of the coordination of wills within the Trinity was to compare the elements of the Trinity to one another by way of analogies. Now, these ideas are a bit older than Augustine. They come before Augustine, but Augustine expresses them in the sort of clearest and most sophisticated way, so I'll focus on his treatment. He wrote a work called On the Trinity, in which he basically said that when one says that Jesus Christ is the Son of the Father, one is affirming a truth, but it's not a literal truth in the biological sense. He's not the biological Son of God the Father. But it's also not a poetic metaphor. It's neither of these two things. What he says is that the word Son is used to describe Christ in an analogical sense. There's a sort of analog between how the word Son can be applied to a human being when you say that one man is the son of another man. But when you apply the word Son to Christ, and you say that Christ is the Son of God, you're using the word Son in an analogical sense. Now, I discussed in a previous video this doctrine of analogy. I associated it with Thomas Aquinas, and that is the thinker in whom this idea is most completely developed. But you see it in Augustine. You get this idea where you can use different analogical senses of a word to try and indirectly make sense of a concept. And Augustine and the other church fathers, and then the scholastics, they explored the logic underlying analogical reasoning with a great deal of subtlety. Augustine moves through a progressively better and better series of analogies when he writes on the Trinity. So that's basically how that problem was solved. Now, onto the problem of evil and divine justice. The classical answer to that problem was once again given by Saint Augustine, and that was done here in this work of his on free choice of the will. And when I say that this is the classical answer, I mean exactly that. This is the typical Christian response. Why is there evil in the world? Because God gives humans free will, and some humans use their free will to do evil. So God is not responsible for evil. The evil is not imputed to him. But it nevertheless happens because he's granted free will to human beings. Now, Augustine sort of ran into a problem here. Because that work on free will that I showed you, it was part of the collection of his anti-Manichaean writings. Okay? This is one of the difficulties that comes with analyzing Augustine's work. a lot of it was written in the heat of debate. As I said, in early Christianity, there were fierce debates about what Christian orthodoxy exactly was going to be. So a lot of it is very polemical, it's very debate-oriented, and he's always arguing with different sects. So when Augustine set down this notion that evil exists because humans have free will, he was attempting to answer and respond to the Manichaean idea, the Manichaean solution to the problem of evil, that there's a good God and an evil God. He said, no, there's only one God, there's just one, but evil exists because some humans use their free will to do evil. Okay, so that came as a result of his response to Manichaeanism. Later on, however, it occurred to Augustine that if human beings have free will and by way of that free will are able to do evil, one could also say that by way of free will, human beings are able to do good. And if they're able to use their free will to do good, then they can also merit salvation merely by way of the strength of their will. But if they're able to merit salvation merely by way of the strength of their will, that makes Christ's sacrifice superfluous. It makes the whole Christian religion otiose and unnecessary. Now, that happens to be the position that Pelagius took. And when Augustine realized this and began debating Pelagius and the other Pelagians, he took a step back. And he then came up with this notion that, yes, free will exists, and humans can do evil with their will, but in order to attain salvation, God must grant one grace. He must infuse his grace into a person, and by doing this, he frees them of all irrational desires. Yeah? He frees them of all irrational desires and of inclinations to evil. And with God's grace and God's assistance, it becomes easier to do good. And also you have divine assistance. You get that divine assistance by way of faith in Christ. So you get this help from God because you believe. Your mind, which was once clouded by irrational desires, no longer is, or at least is to a lesser extent. And then Augustine says, well, then you still need free will. There's still room for free will. You still need to keep using your free will to continue doing good things, even after God has infused you with his grace. But the grace is still a necessary component. Okay? So that was the way that Augustine tried to strike a balance between these two poles. Now, one other thing about how Augustine thought of the will. When he wrote about free will, he essentially inherited the old Greek rationalist conception. So, according to the Greeks, if one lived in accord with reason, one was therefore free. There was no diminution in freedom involved in having the will do what reason told it to do. It is only when the will, when you are clouded by irrational desires and therefore no longer determining your ends and your actions according to reason, that you are unfree. Right? So you can sort of be possessed by irrational desires. Augustine took over this concept, and he said that without divine grace, one is overcome by all sorts of irrational passions, torn willy-nilly. You see this a lot in the Confessions, when he writes about how he was before his conversion to Christianity. Augustine says that he was, you know, a total dissolute. He was basically a complete degenerate. He couldn't control his desires. But then, you know, God came along, infused him with grace, saved him, and this enabled him to regain a measure of self-control. So he inherits this Greek concept that one is free if one lives in accordance with reason, and not free if one is held captive by sin or by irrational desires. It comes to the same thing in the end, those two things. And of course, he saw God as being primarily exemplified within reason. So the end of a Christian life is to bring one's own will into accordance with divine reason, with the divine logos. And that was the way that Augustine and the other early Christian theologians solved the problem of coordinating human wills with the divine will. So you've got now, within early Christianity, solutions to these major problems that I pointed out. The problem of evil and divine justice, the problem of coordinating the wills within the Trinity, and then the problem of coordinating the human will with the will of God. And Augustine was crucially important in setting out these answers. Now, there's a problem here. Since a lot of Augustine's writing was composed in the midst of debates, he tends to take strong positions on one side at one time, and then completely different positions at another time. And I already alluded to this. So when he argued against the Manichaeans, he put strong emphasis on free will. But then when he argued against the Pelagians, he completely did away with that and said, no, divine grace is crucial. Now, he later tried to combine these two things, and the scholastics followed up on that. But by doing this, they created another problem, which is, how does one reconcile divine foreknowledge with human freedom? And this is still a major theological problem today. Now, a lot of the scholastics, this is moving later, a lot of the scholastics tried to come up with solutions to this problem, and many of them were quite bad, quite unconvincing. St. Anselm, for example, tried to argue that human beings are free, and they have free will, and that they have free will despite the fact that God's foreknowledge foreordains and predetermines everything. So somehow, human freedom and divine predestination are supposed to be compatible. This was not really clearly explained at all. Then there was, just to give another example of a theologian, there's Bernard of Clairvaux, who you may know, if you're into medieval history, you may know him as the one who set down the rule for the Knights Templar. But he was also a philosopher and a theologian. And his attempt to deal with this problem of coordinating divine foreknowledge with human freedom was to say, well, there are different spheres within which each of the two wills can act. So there's a sphere reserved just for the human will, where the human will is causatively effective, and then there's a sphere for the divine will, where that is causatively effective. The problem is, he doesn't make clear what the distinction between these two spheres is. How can we demarcate the one from the other? These problems are not really dealt with adequately. There's another medieval thinker that I want to mention especially, because some of his ideas actually tie in very nicely to a major part of the current contemporary debate about free will that's going on now in philosophical circles. And that is Bonaventure. And he tried to reconcile divine foreknowledge and therefore seemingly predestination with human freedom by saying this, that God's foreknowledge does not impose any sort of external constraints among the human will, and therefore if there are no external constraints imposed on the human will is free. Now, the problem with that answer is that it doesn't do anything to address the problem of internal constraints on the human will. He simply ignores that portion of the problem, and he says that all that one truly needs to be free is to be free of the external constraints. So Bonaventure solves the problem of reconciling human freedom with divine foreknowledge by simply defining it out of existence. Now, the funny thing about this is that this is basically the same argument that compatibilists about free will make today, except shorn of all of its theological drapery. So, a compatibilist, for those who don't know philosophical terminology, is someone who believes that free will is compatible with determinism. So, they're not really thinking in terms of divine predestination anymore, it's just determinism in terms of, natural kind of events, physical events following with their physical necessity, and that predetermines things and so on. That sort of determinism. Compatibilists say that determinism in that sense is compatible with human freedom. Now, I say they make the same argument, and I can give you an example of a compatibilist who really does make the same argument, and that is Daniel Dennett, and he makes it in this book, Elbow Room. What Dennett basically says is that we have this he establishes this thing that he calls the root idea of control. And the root idea of control for Dennett is this. To say that one thing is controlled by another is to say that that second thing, the controller, is an agent of some kind, and that that agent exercises his will on the thing being controlled. Okay? So, if you are under control, then you are under the control of an agent. There's an agent who's controlling you. However, determinism doesn't really state anything about agents. It's just about a natural causative sequence of physical events following by natural physical necessity. There are no agents involved. And so since there's no agent controlling you by determinism, therefore you are free. And so in that sense, free will is compatible with determinism. But again, the problem with Dennett's solution to this is that he does the same thing Bonaventura did. He defines the problem out of existence. I mean, why is that relevant? What about internal sources in the will? If determinism is true, wouldn't it be the case that whatever it is that's responsible for the workings of our will is also predetermined? I mean, if you believe in universal determinism, you'd have to say that. And Dennett really just kind of ignores the problem and defines it out of existence. So yeah, not Dennett's finest hour, in my opinion. Although, to be honest, I don't think he's a very good philosopher in general. I'm not going to bother to defend or justify that assertion here. That would take me much too far, of course. But if anyone watches this and I happen to piss you off by saying that Dennett's a bad philosopher, whatever. We can settle it in the comments. I'm not going to justify that here. By the way, for anyone interested, there's the best response to people like Dennett, to compatibilists, from the perspective of an incompatibilist, someone who believes that free will and determinism are not compatible, that they can't both be true. If we have free will, determinism is false. If determinism is true, we don't have free will. That's what incompatibilism is. The best book defending incompatibilism, by far, I think, is this. Peter Van Inwagen's Essay on Free Will. Excellent book. Fantastic book. Not easy to read. You really have to be able to follow philosophical arguments very well, and it's not written in a way to make it a book that you could read on the beach, let's say. It's not an easy book to read, but it's an extremely good book. It's argued with just the absolute highest standards of rigor. And what I love about it is that he really bends over backwards to try and make the compatibilist case as strong as possible. Van Inwagen really goes out of his way to try and make the compatibilists look good and to grant them as many assumptions or things as he possibly can. And compatibilism still doesn't work out. It's a great book. So if you want, you know, some kind of challenging philosophical material to read, I'd go for that. He also has a chapter on fatalism, by the way, which might also interest those watching this, especially when I get to my discussion of the debate between Luther and Erasmus, which I know has been a long time coming. Okay, so this problem of reconciling divine foreknowledge with human freedom had come up. And the scholastics really tried to solve this problem, and you see this exemplified in its most developed state in the work of Thomas Aquinas, is to say that true human freedom, to be truly free, is to live in accordance with reason. If you are beset by irrational passions and controlled by them, to that extent you're not really free. And he added to that the belief that the supreme moment of divinity, the most important portion of God's nature, was his rationality, his intellect. So if one lived in accordance with reason, one ultimately lived in accordance with God. So that's how you coordinate divine and human will. And if you live in accordance with reason, well, then you're truly free. So that's the sense in which human freedom is compatible with divine foreknowledge. Because if you're not living in accordance with reason, you're not really free. That's the way they dealt with that problem. Now, this approach is attractive in many respects. There's a lot to be said for it. It's very good in many ways, but it's not without its problems. The most obvious one just has to do with pointing out the fact that nominalists had something to say about it. If you say that God is ultimately subject to reason because reason is the supreme moment of divine being, you sort of seem to be subjecting God to reason, right? And if you're subjecting God to reason, can you really say that he's truly omnipotent? Because if you really want to think about what omnipotence means, there is a sort of intuition that the nominalists built off of, which is that if God is truly omnipotent, if he's really supremely powerful, reason should not be able to constrain him. That's ultimately where this nominalistic concept of radical omnipotence comes from. It's really in response to this, because they believed that the scholastics, in their emphasis on divine reason, were really sort of not offering the proper respect to God's power. Okay, so that's where that came from. Okay, so the nominalist revolution didn't come out of nowhere. Now, there's one final thing I want to say in this extremely long and winding background, and that is that I've now discussed basically two concepts of the will. There is the old pre-modern concept, which says that to be free, the will must be governed by reason, and to the extent that it's beset by irrational passions, it is not free. And then there's the modern concept, which just says that the essence of will is simply to be able to choose between differing alternatives. And whether one chooses between these alternatives on a reasonable or rational basis or not is irrelevant to the question of freedom. You could choose something for completely stupid and irrational reasons, but that doesn't mean you aren't free, according to the more modern conception. Now, from these two notions of the will actually come two ways of looking at freedom in a political sense. Okay? And here, in this connection, I want to bring up a very famous essay by a historian of political thought named Isaiah Berlin. And the essay is called Two Concepts of Liberty. I'm sure you can find it as a PDF online, but it's also included in this book. Here you go, Liberty. It's got that essay, Two Concepts of Liberty, as well as a few other good ones. Oh, by the way, when I was in high school, I was a big fan of Berlin's work. I loved it, and I think he writes beautifully. There's still a lot of good things that I think are in it. I've become more critical of him since. There are issues where I diverge with him. I think his interpretation of the beliefs of certain thinkers is flawed. He also praises John Stuart Mill to a great extent. He thinks that Mill was, the culmination of liberalism. I completely disagree. I think Mill is a disaster for liberalism. He's probably the most overrated figure in the history of political thought. It's actually with Mill that you get this idea that society, in order to be free, must be tolerant of aberrant lifestyles, okay? And if you push this too far, if you make this a central element of what is required for freedom, then you do get to the kind of, degenerate, left-swamped, social justice warrior-swamped society that we currently see, where if you're not accepting of all of these, unconventional lifestyles, if you have anything critical of them to say, forget about suppressing them with violence. We're not even talking about that. We're just talking about not tolerating them personally. Just if you say anything to denounce them, you're a bigot, you're evil, you're a colonialist, white male, heteronormative, patriarchal, blah, 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 blah. I blame Mill for that. So to the extent that Berlin praises Mill, I have to disagree with him. Mill is horrible. I might make a video just on John Stuart Mill one day to talk about how horrible he is. Anyway, now, in Two Concepts of Liberty, in the essay that I want to discuss, Berlin brings up two notions of liberty, negative and positive liberty. Now, negative liberty is just, as he defines it, and there are problems with this essay as well. The main one is that he's just horrifically imprecise in how he uses his terms. But I use this as a starting point for discussion just because it's a popular essay and because there's a certain critique that he presents of the other conception of liberty, positive liberty, that I want to point out here as well. Okay, so negative liberty, as Berlin defines it, is just freedom from interference by other people. That is, the freedom to pursue one's ends unimpeded by others. Okay? This doesn't mean that you will successfully achieve your ends. It just means that you're able to pursue them and that no one will get in your way if you should choose to pursue them. That's what negative liberty is. Positive liberty is really self-mastery. Okay? The ability to direct oneself toward the ends that one wants. Now, you can see very clearly with this distinction of these two kinds of political liberty, they correlate very nicely to the two concepts of the will that I mentioned. The old pre-modern rationalistic concept matches up nicely with positive liberty, and the more modern nominalistic voluntaristic notion of the will matches nicely with negative liberty. Okay, so according to the old pre-modern notion of the will, if you're beset by irrational desires and cannot control yourself, and you can only control yourself if you are ruled by reason, then to that extent you aren't free. Well, positive liberty also says that if you are lacking in self-mastery, you are to that extent unfree. And so on for the other conceptions. They match up very nicely. So what I want to say with this is that even though nominalism inaugurated this modern nominalistic concept of the will that's associated with negative liberty, and even though nominalism is also responsible for a lot of the current social degeneracy that we see today, because the modern concept of the will is essentially nihilistic, even though it's responsible for all of these bad things, and I've already begun explaining some of that in these videos, and I'll do that to a greater extent as they go on, I don't want to be interpreted as saying that the way to solve the problems of modern society is to simply reject the modern nominalistic notion of the will and to go back to the old pre-nominalistic, pre-modern, ancient notion. It's not that simple. It's not that easy. This is a much more difficult problem that we're faced with here. And the reason that it is a more difficult problem than that is that this old pre-modern rationalistic concept of the will, and therefore the positive political liberty associated with it, is entirely compatible with the worst, most horrific kind of totalitarianism that you can imagine. Okay? So think of this. You have a certain political class, a certain ruling class. They decide that there are a certain series of ends that one can legitimately pursue and be considered rational if one pursues them. And then there is another set of ends which, if one pursues them, designates one irrational. Okay? And suppose that this political class accepts the pre-modern notion of the will, that if you do not act in accordance with rationality, you are not therefore free. That means that they can take people who do these designated irrational things, they can coerce them, they can subject them to violence, and then say to them, I am coercing you in the name of setting you free. Now, I hope you can understand why that's a little perverse. Okay? I hope you can understand why that's a little nuts. And Berlin points out that that's actually what happened in the French Revolution. Rousseau had this bizarre sort of semi-rationalistic, almost theological notion of freedom, because he had this concept of the general will, right? And the general will was sort of a placeholder for God in Rousseau's thought. And the ultimate measure of one's rationality and therefore one's freedom is one's conformity to the general will. And so if you're not conforming to the general will, you're not being rational. And if you're not being rational, you're not being your true self because you're not really controlling yourself. And if you're not your true self, then you're not free. And so you have this bizarre situation where Robespierre and the other leaders of the French Revolution can get up and say, unironically, we must force the people to be free. So there's this really perverse aspect to positive liberty. Okay? So the solution to the problems of modernity, even though the problems of modernity lie in the modern nominalist negative notion of freedom and the will, is not to simply abandon this notion to core. You don't abandon it completely, because if you do, and you immerse yourself totally in the positive notion, this possibility for horrific totalitarianism reemerges. Now, there are some people on the alt-right, and I mention them again, and this is particularly people interested in traditionalism in the style of someone like Julius Evola, traditionalist Catholics, that sort of thing. A lot of these people realize that modern decadence, a lot of modern problems came out of the nominalist revolution and its notion of the will, and they draw the conclusion that therefore we have to completely abandon that notion and replace it by the older positive notion. And I think the people who say this simply have not treated the sort of critique that I've presented and that Berlin presents in his essay with sufficient seriousness. So once again, in a kind of friendly way, because as I said, I do sympathize with a lot of what they do, and I support their crusade against the left. I think it's healthy. I think it's good. Nevertheless, I want to sort of, in a friendly kind of way, wag my finger at these people and say, listen, there are certain ideas that you have not hitherto treated with enough seriousness. So it's not as simple as simply rejecting the nominalist notion of the will. This is despite the fact that, as I said, the nominalist idea of the will and the negative political freedom associated with it has nihilistic consequences. Because remember, if the essence of freedom is to simply be to not be constrained by other things and to not have one's sphere of choice reduced, then anything which reduces one's sphere of choice, traditional morality, gender roles, anything like that, traditional religion, any sort of social structure that attempts to give a moral compass to society, you can say, you can attack this as being, as curtailing freedom. And so then you reach the conclusion that in the name of freedom, we must destroy all of these things. But then that leads you to saying that in the name of freedom, you have to more or less destroy everything. You have to destroy the entire moral fabric to set yourself free. Because remember, the will is not to be constrained by anything, otherwise it's not free. There's nothing that can direct your choice other than pure will. So the pre-modern concept, the older ancient concept of the will, can lead to totalitarianism if taken too far, and that's a problem. And the modern nominalistic concept of the will leads to nihilism if taken too far, and that's a problem, and we see that now. So what I would say is, if you're a reactionary, if you sympathize with the reactor sphere in any way, your true task should be to find a way to strike a proper balance between these two things and to not overemphasize the one over the other. That seems to me like the principal philosophical problem that the reactor sphere should be concerned with. Okay. So having said all of that, with that extremely long buildup, now we can get to the debate between Luther and Erasmus. Okay. Now, Erasmus, remember, wanted to initiate a program of reform within the church. And he wanted to do this by way of education. So he had this humanistic educational program that he devised, and he wanted to implement it and thereby improve the morality of those in power and those in the church and sort of fix the corruptions of the church that way. Luther did not agree with this. He wanted an immediate, swift reformation. He wanted to sweep aside the whole church because he thought that the Catholic Church and its doctrine of works was basically satanic and unchristian. And so therefore, in order to do God's work, thought Luther, you had to sweep the whole thing aside. So, although both Erasmus and Luther were interested in reform, Erasmus was a moderate and Luther was a radical. They also had very different temperaments. As befits his sort of moderate position, Erasmus had a very moderate temperament. He was a very mild sort of guy. He was careful not to offend too many people or to push things too far. He wanted to kind of strike deals with people, to meet them halfway, and to try and sort of tilt them in what he took to be the proper direction, but not to be too forceful because that could lead to conflict, to war possibly even, and would wreak untold destruction. And Erasmus was a pacifist because he believed that Christian teaching mandated pacifism. Okay, so Luther, on the other hand, was totally the opposite. He was a very passionate and intense guy, very strident, very uncompromising. You know, he was not for any kind of namby-pamby stuff at all. Luther was straight to the point, brutally honest, very strident, and just unwilling to meet anyone halfway. Erasmus didn't like this. He didn't like this kind of vehemence. He thought it was, he thought that it promoted conflict, that it threatened to throw the world into disarray. And he grew very frustrated with Luther in this. He initially supported Luther's program to reform the church, his efforts to institute a reformation, but he disliked the vehemence with which Luther was doing everything. See, Luther's position was, look, the truth is the truth. God has revealed it to us through Scripture. Period. That's it. There's nothing to debate. There's nothing to discuss. The truth is what it is. God has revealed it, and we must work to institute it. And earthly peace should never be purchased at the price of inciting God's anger. Erasmus thought that accommodation was a religious duty. So their temperaments clashed in that respect. Now, that said, a lot of people were surprised that they ultimately butted heads. Because, again, they both had a great deal of humanistic training, and they both wanted to initiate a program of reform within the church to improve morals and so on. Many people even thought that Luther was a follower of Erasmus. Some other people thought that Erasmus was secretly a Lutheran. You know, many even believed that they were allies. There are only certain people who knew them both well, like Philip Melanchthon, for example, who was able to see that they would clash eventually, that they would butt heads. So here is Luther carrying out this vehement, strident program of reform and simply saying, look, Scripture speaks directly to the Christian, God seizes you, and after that, that's it. There's no room for debate. It's done. The truth is the truth. And, you know, you either accept the truth or you accept damnation. And that's the end of it for Luther. Erasmus originally tried to encourage Luther's attempts, and he stuck up for him against, you know, various princely and churchly authorities. But he began to grow increasingly exasperated with Luther's vehemence. And slowly but surely, tensions between them began to build. Now, Erasmus got into trouble because he, in conformity with his own moderate temperament, sought once again to be a moderate, to be a mediator, to try and sort of bring Luther and the church together, to get them to meet each other halfway and to avoid schism. And this upset both sides. The Catholics were upset at Erasmus because he was not attacking Luther, and the Lutherans were upset at Erasmus because he wasn't taking his place at Luther's side. So everyone thought that he was dissembling, everyone thought that he was trying to have it both ways, and nobody was happy with what he was doing. But as Luther began to grow more vehement, and as Erasmus began to grow more upset about this, Luther essentially in this way forced Erasmus into the arms of the church when he wouldn't normally have done that. And then pressure began to build on Erasmus, first from Henry VIII, this is before Anglicanism, and then from the Pope to come out against Luther and attack him. And eventually he had no choice, he had to succumb to this pressure, and he did it. Now many Catholics expected him to come out against Luther by asserting papal supremacy. Erasmus chose not to do that. He very deliberately chose a more philosophical and less divisive topic, namely the question of free will. And again, Erasmus was forced into a very uncomfortable position here, because actually one thing that happened earlier is Luther basically said, okay, look, I want Erasmus on my side, but if he won't join me, that's fine. All I ask is that he not attack me. That was Luther's view. Luther said that as long as Erasmus didn't attack him, he would not attack Erasmus. And when this became public knowledge, it again made Erasmus look really bad, because it made it seem like he had some sort of secret pact with Luther, which of course he didn't. That wasn't true. But Erasmus was eventually forced to attack him, and he chose this mild philosophical topic, like free will, and in keeping with his temperamental mildness, he framed the discussion in the following way. He didn't want this to look like a debate. He said, I have certain doubts about something. He said there are certain things that confused him, and he wanted to have these doubts resolved by way of a friendly discussion with Luther. So he began talking about free will, and he began offering certain criticisms of Luther, but he took care to phrase them in a way that was very mild so that Luther wouldn't get offended. This didn't work. Luther was furious, but I'll get to that later. So Erasmus starts out by saying that there doesn't seem to be any sort of criterion that Luther offers for how to evaluate correct scriptural interpretations from incorrect ones. All that Luther says is that when one reads scripture, one is directly seized by the word of God. God enters into the human soul, infuses his grace into you, and then he inspires you, and at that point it's simply no longer possible to doubt anymore. You have indubitable certain knowledge revealed to you by God. You're infused with a sense of divine mission. You know the truth, and that's the end of it. But Erasmus points out, well, these things that you describe, they're all subjective experiences. Why should we trust your subjective experiences? Why should we trust anyone's subjective experiences? We have no access to them. Okay? So, and for that matter, why should we trust our own subjective experiences? I mean, we might be under the sway of illusion. Also, there are parts of Scripture that are unclear, that are uncertain, and that there's disagreement about how to interpret these things. Why be so strident? He actually accuses Luther of pretending to occupy the place of God and of declaring things from on high. Why should we do this? So Erasmus basically advocates a kind of semi-skepticism tempered by what he takes to be Augustinianism. So I should point out first that when he wrote against Luther, and he wrote this essay on him called On Free Will, I think it was called On the Freedom of the Will, Diatribe or Discussion, and he attempted to initiate Luther into a conversation, as I said, but he also framed the discussion in terms of this earlier ancient debate between the Epicureans, the Stoics, and the Skeptics that I discussed. And he looked at Luther as sort of being akin to one of the Stoics, because the Stoics believed in these kind of indubitable cataleptic impressions that are irresistible, that you can't possibly deny the truth of. And Luther seemed to look at Scripture in the same way, that when God's word grips you, that's it. All doubts end. For the reasons that I just described earlier, Erasmus took on a sort of skeptical position, but he also tried to portray himself as an Augustinian. And he said, okay, look, one of the problems with Luther's theology is that it attributes absolute power to God and no power whatsoever to the human will. And this was the central disagreement between them. He said, listen, if God is supremely powerful in this way, doesn't this make him responsible for evil? Human beings have no power to will anything on their own, so how can they be held responsible for evil? And if they're not responsible for evil, how can God justly damn them, and therefore how can God be just? How can we love such a God? In other words, Erasmus accuses Luther of building divine omnipotence to the point where it shatters divine goodness. So what Erasmus also says, look, there are five positions that you can hold on the question of the will, of the human will, and its potential for granting one or giving one or leading one to salvation. So first is the Pelagian position, which held that extreme acts of goodness, kindness, generosity, etc., can merit salvation even without faith, or without grace, or without God's assistance in any way. Then there's the Scotist position, the position of John Duns Scotus, who was an earlier philosopher some centuries before, which was a kind of mild semi-Pelagianism, which said that even without God's grace, it is nevertheless possible for people to perform good actions, to do good things, and therefore to incline God in the direction of saving them, even if he doesn't outright save them. He's at least inclined in that direction. The third position is Augustine's position, the sort of position that I described above, where he tries to synthesize this belief that humans do have free will, but also that without divine grace, acting in concord with human free will, salvation is impossible. Then there's also the position of Karlstadt, who was another theologian, who basically said that without divine grace, humans do not have the freedom to do good. They can't do good. Even an action that seems like it's good isn't really good if the person doing it hasn't been infused with God's grace first. So without divine grace, the only thing that humans are free to do, according to Karlstadt, is sin, is to do evil. And then there's Luther's position, which is even more extreme. And that held that without God, human beings are not free to do anything. They have no free will at all. They can't do evil, they can't do good, they can't do anything. And of these five positions, Erasmus takes the Pelagian view, Karlstadt's view, and Luther's view to be heterodox. He takes the Scotist view to be acceptable but wrong, and the Augustinian position, which he says is his position, to be the true and the orthodox position. So he sort of tries to present himself as an Augustinian moderate, fortified by skepticism. Okay, now, here's the problem with this. There's reason to doubt that Erasmus was being totally honest, because if you compare that work against Luther on free will, some of his other writings on the will, Erasmus takes a much stronger position on the strength of the will. He says often, for example, that the will is the power to do either good or evil. There are some cases where he seems to think something close to what Ficino believed, that the world is pervaded by a kind of divine love that naturally inclines everyone toward the good. He also, in many of his other writings, talks about how certain pagans, for example, virtuous pagans like Socrates and Cicero, who obviously were not Christians, could not have been Christians, were saved. He even says in one of his works somewhere, he has one of his characters say that he's offering a prayer to Socrates. It's kind of strange, kind of strange to reconcile that with that seemingly moderate position. It looks a lot more Pelagian when he says it that way. He also speaks about man's natural goal in supernatural terms quite often in many of his writings, but he never mentions grace. He always de-emphasizes it, and he always seems to be more concerned with issues in the here and now. So despite the sort of moderate position that he sketched out, you can accuse him, justly, I think, and Luther would go on to do that, of dissembling, of trying to fool people, of presenting himself as more moderate than he really was, and of hiding his true, more Pelagian position. Now, when Luther found out that Erasmus had written something attacking him, as I said, he flew into a rage. He was furious. He described the act as a great refusal. Basically, Luther's reaction was, okay, that's it, this means war. Melanchthon, who was his friend, Philip Melanchthon, a fellow Protestant, he tried to calm him down. He said, look, Erasmus went to great pains to sound moderate and inoffensive. You know, calm down. It didn't work. It didn't succeed in calming him down. When Luther picked up Erasmus's diatribe, and by the way, the word diatribe in those days did not have the pejorative connotations that it does now. A diatribe just meant a kind of discussion, you know, a dialectical exchange of arguments between people. That's all it was. It's a form of rhetoric. So it doesn't have the pejorative connotations that it does now. But he read Erasmus's diatribe, and as he was reading it, he repeatedly just wanted to throw it across the room. He was so angry. Luther's response was a long time in coming, but when it finally came, it was totally uncompromising. Okay, his response was titled On the Bondage of the Will. And it's interesting that he chose this title, Bondage of the Will, because that's actually a phrase that Augustine often used in his own writings against Pelagians. So immediately you see Luther trying to frame the debate as Erasmus is a Pelagian, I'm the Orthodox Augustinian. He's the heretic, I'm the true Christian. Now, he goes on further to try to frame the whole thing like it's a judicial proceeding. Erasmus, in his initial piece, wanted to frame things as a discussion. Luther totally rejects this opening. He frames things in this way. He says, look, Erasmus is a dissembler, he's slippery, he's tricky. He even says at one point, Erasmus is slippery as an eel and only Christ can grab him. So he wants to portray Erasmus as this kind of sophist who's sort of lying, being all tricky. And he frames it again as a judicial proceeding. So Luther portrays himself as sort of the emissary and representative of God. And here he is to convict Erasmus of heresy, of heterodoxy, etc. So he goes on to say that the skeptical position that Erasmus takes on many things, including scriptural interpretation, is simply unchristian, pure and simple. A true Christian, according to Luther, cannot doubt. You read scripture, you're seized by the word of God, and God in his power eliminates all your doubts. That's it. They're gone. Doubt, according to Luther, was just the worst thing. And the only thing that could ultimately resolve that doubt was God in his omnipotence. Okay, so he then goes on to attack Erasmus for what Luther believes to be his Pelagianism. And he basically says that we're not to be skeptical, we're not to engage in discussion, we're simply to affirm and profess our faith. And that's it. And he has the famous phrase in his piece there where he says, the Holy Spirit is not a skeptic. We don't doubt. God infuses us with faith, and that's the end of it. He goes on further and becomes even more radical. And he introduces the following really striking image. He says that basically humans are like beasts, and that two riders, God and Satan, compete with one another to ride this beast. And that's sort of a metaphor for God and the devil competing with one another to gain control of human souls. And in that way, he sort of just tries to depict things in a kind of Manichaean way. Erasmus eventually wound up accusing Luther of Manichaeanism. Now, I should say that this isn't exactly correct. This is not a Manichaean position, because if you take Luther's view of just total overpowering divine omnipotence, then the devil himself is a creature. And if the devil himself is a creature, then the devil himself is ultimately subject to God. He's ultimately a slave to God, just like all the rest of us are. And that's a huge problem. If the devil is a slave to God, doesn't that make God responsible for evil? Doesn't that make the devil almost like an innocent victim? It looks really strange. And Erasmus, in his response to Luther later on, pointed out these things and, you know, expressed great worry about them. But, so he takes this image of the human being as a beast for which two riders, God and the devil, compete. And he believes that this is an orthodox view. He's wrong. It's not. It doesn't appear anywhere in Scripture. It doesn't appear anywhere among the church fathers or scholastics. There's nothing within Christian tradition that makes a precedent for this. So he completely breaks with Christian tradition in this regard. And he demonstrates himself to be like a total, outright theological fatalist here. So everything is determined by God. Now, Luther probably did not know that this was heterodox, that this was unorthodox. And he didn't know this because there's a piece of writing called the Hypognosticon that in that day was mistakenly attributed to Augustine. It was believed that Augustine wrote it, and in that same image of the human being as a beast competed over by either God or the devil was used. Luther believed that Augustine wrote that. So when he used that image, he was just saying, look, I'm just an Augustinian. I'm totally orthodox here. But that wasn't written by Augustine. Luther didn't know that, though. There's another exasperating thing about Luther's response to Erasmus. He hurls a lot of insults at him. A lot. There's a lot of ad hominem attacks. As I said, Luther was a very intense, strident guy. And that makes it rather annoying to read. He says that he's really a skeptic, an Epicurean, a Pelagian, and therefore ultimately that he's the devil, that the devil is sort of using Erasmus as his tool, or he's hiding within him to work his evil. So he actually saw the whole thing in apocalyptic terms. Luther saw it as his own battle against the devil when he debated Erasmus. This was not a friendly debate to him, obviously. So that was very exasperating. Now, as I said, there are an enormous amount of problems with the position that Luther sketches out in On the Bondage of the Will. For one thing, it seems to make God responsible for evil. Now, Luther's response to this is that we must not contemplate God in his full glory, in his full omnipotence. I mentioned this in my video on Luther, that the Christian's duty is simply to restrict oneself to Scripture, to look at God as he has chosen to portray himself within Scripture, and to ignore speculation about divine omnipotence. Now, there's a big problem with this. The very certainty that Luther wants to attach to his view of scriptural interpretation, because remember, you're ultimately seized by God and so on, the very certainty that he wants to ground this all in is based on divine omnipotence. But the only way to maintain that certainty is not to speculate about divine omnipotence, because remember, if God is omnipotent in the way the nominalist said, then he's not bound to keep his promises, he's not bound to save you, and there's no reason to believe that what you think is God seizing you might not just be the devil. You might be deceived. You might be, etc., etc. Things also got really bad for Luther because the stridency of his response to Erasmus ultimately empowered the radical wing of the reformers, these kind of enthusiasts, as I called them, the people who believed in direct personal revelation. Luther actually disagreed with this, but because he said that revelation trumped morality, he really had no basis to argue against them, And you had in the Radical Reformation this ultimate, ascendancy of this kind of hyper-subjectivized view of religion and of divine mission. So you get these people who have these subjective, transformative religious experiences, and they claim to be grasped by God, and they become totally fanatical. once again, a comparison to social justice warriors is apt here, right? They're completely sure of themselves. They don't doubt anything. They act as if they're on a crusade against evil. They act as if they're imbued with a sense of divine mission. And as I said, they're totally sure of themselves, right? And the whole thing is based on their subjective feelings. Right. So, Erasmus responded to Luther with a long two-volume work called Hyperaspistes. Now, Gillespie translates this in two different ways. Once he translates it as the shield bearer, and another time he translates it as the warrior bearing a shield, which I guess is sort of similar, but it's not exactly the same, and I don't know why he doesn't maintain a consistent translation. But anyway, that work is a work of pure self-defense. Most of it is concerned with Erasmus rebutting Luther's ad hominem attacks and all of his charges of lying, dissembling, of being the devil in disguise, that sort of thing. I'm not really going to discuss that. It's not really relevant here. Also, there's no evidence that Luther actually read it. But it sort of went on like that. And in addition to that, he also actually wound up taking a stronger, more Pelagian position as a result of what Luther had written. He also said, look, salvation cannot be based purely on faith alone, because then you have to say that virtuous pagans like Socrates and evil pagans like Nero are both condemned, and isn't that ridiculous? Doesn't that make God evil? I mean, clearly there's a moral difference between Socrates and Nero. Clearly one of them is evil and the other is not. And also, how can a just God sentence a virtuous pagan to eternal torment in hell? You know, suppose you were a genuinely good person, you loved your wife, you loved your children, you were generous to your friends, and you tried your best to live a good life, but you happened never to have heard of Christianity. Aren't you accusing God of being evil if you say that he would condemn such a person to hell? He makes further arguments like this. And he also says, look, human beings were free before the fall, but after the fall, the human will was corrupted. And this corruption gave us an inclination toward evil, but it didn't extinguish totally the spark of goodness and of reason within us. So Erasmus seems to adopt a position here that says that for almost anyone, there seems to be this, however small, yet totally ineradicable kernel of goodness within everyone. Everyone has the potential, according to him, it seems, to do good, to be good, and so on. And so if one happens to be evil, this is mostly a result of poor education, poor upbringing, and so on. Another comparison is apt here. You see this in a lot of people who attribute race or sex differences, various performance at various tasks, on environment. Why are there not many female engineers? Well, they're not raised. Girls are not raised to like math. And, you know, they're taught that that's a thing for boys. That sort of thing. That kind of social constructivism. I may have mentioned this in my initial video, but there is a philosopher named Ian Hacking who actually traces all forms of social constructivism within the social sciences to nominalism. And remember, Luther and Erasmus both came out of nominalism. That might be something interesting to discuss at some point. So, Erasmus asserts this almost ineradicable kernel of human goodness. He says, yes, grace is necessary, but nevertheless, the will has power. I think the way Erasmus puts it against Luther is you mistake an injury for death. You know, that the fall injured the human will. It inclined it towards evil to an extent that it hadn't been inclined before, but it didn't utterly destroy it. So he sort of says it that way. So he just tries to reassert some power or some dignity to the human will. And he sees this as necessary both to dignify man and to acquit God of the charge of being evil. So the debate essentially proceeded that way. Now, as this conflict makes clear, humanism and Protestantism cannot both be true. They're irreconcilably in conflict. And yet they're both responses to nominalism, and they both have problems with each other. Humanism emphasizes man too much, especially in its more extreme manifestations, and Protestantism is theologically fatalist. It reduces man to a nullity. So they can't be reconciled, and they both have problems with one another. And that means that if one is to craft a durable and lasting response to nominalism, one has to transcend these two things and come up with a third response. And that's what people eventually realized, and that eventually got us to naturalism. The scientific naturalism, the scientific revolution, and so on. It was and in scientific naturalism, one emphasizes not man as primary, as the humanists did, and not God, as the Protestants did, but nature as the primary thing to be considered within one's metaphysic, one's view of the world. And that's what I'll be discussing later in future videos. Now, I just want to end this by calling attention to a wonderful image that Gillespie gives at the end of his chapter on the debate between Luther and Erasmus. And he talks about the Sistine Chapel. In 1513, Michelangelo was invited to paint the ceiling of the Sistine Chapel, and it's got this, you know, heroic kind of imagery. It's a Christian painting, but it's in a very classical style. You know, you have these, like, super muscular kind of, nude figures. And in 1513, the humanist movement was at its apex. At its apotheosis, it was at its highest point. And you see this confidence and this strength reflected there. However, 21 years later, in 1534, Michelangelo was called to the Sistine Chapel again to paint one of the altar walls. And this painting was very different. It was dark. It centered around Christ, and he appeared as this kind of harsh judge. There was this air of foreboding in the painting. It's very terrifying and uncertain. And this reflects what had been going on in the broader world. Because in just that short period, from 1513 to 1534, humanism went from being totally ascendant to being shattered. And Luther is largely responsible for having shattered it. The problem is that the kind of religious passions that Luther's theology lit a flame under, lit a spark under and ignited, were the passions that have ultimately erupted in the wars of religion and the just absolutely horrific violence that came out of those wars. Now, calling them the wars of religion is something of a misnomer. I mean, the expansion of the state was also important. They were the wars necessary for the state to assert its power and so on. But it's really in the carnage, the flames and the horror of these wars that the modern world is born, because Protestantism destroyed the optimistic worldview of humanism, and the horrific carnage of the wars of religion shattered confidence in that kind of extreme religious faith advocated by Luther. So a third way had to be devised, and that was naturalism, and that is what I will be discussing next. In the next video, I'll be discussing René Descartes, who's considered to be the father of modern philosophy, and here we will actually be getting to the modern world and to the naturalistic conceptions and ideas associated with it. That's all for now. Thank you for listening.